Recorded Books presents A Month of Doomsdays by William W. Johnstone and J.A. Johnstone. Narrated by me, George Guidall. Chapter 1.
Don't let him get away! Cut him off!
Tynan Brannigan urged his sure-footed coyote dun to greater speed. The valiant horse did not disappoint him and took off like a 4th of July rocket. Tynan bent low, played out a loop on his lariat, and let fly.
You got him, Pa!
Matthew Brannigan threw his arm up high in the air to show his appreciation. It almost got him unseated. His horse veered close to a post oak with a low-hanging branch. The 19-year-old ducked at the last instant. Twigs cut at his face and hand, but did not slow his exuberant advance.
"Hurt him!" Ty called. "The ground's turning rocky. I don't want him busting a leg."
Matthew raked his heels against his horse's flanks and cut off the steer as it tried to double back in front of his paw. This tactic was instinctive. The rope would tangle up the dun's legs and give a faint hope of escape, as if the steer had anywhere to go other than the Powderhorn Ranch's wide-open grasslands. Ty let his horse dig in its heels. The rope snapped taut. Together with his son blocking any other possible escape, the steer was caught well and good. The sudden yank on the rope took it off its feet. With a heavy thud, it landed on its side.
"Hog tie him, Pa?"
"No reason to do that. This isn't a rodeo, and that's no calf. You'd get yourself gored if you mess with him."
"He's powerful mad,"
Matt agreed. "Give him a second to cool off. He's remembering earlier times when things didn't go well for him. Get him back to the herd. He'll twig to the fact that we're not branding him like was done a couple seasons back."
Ty sent a ripple along the rope to loosen the loop. The Circle P brand shone brightly on heaving hindquarters, turned up to the afternoon Wyoming sun as if it was made from the purest silver.
Ty tossed his end of the rope to his son.
"Where are you going?"
Matthew secured the end of the rope around his saddle horn. He had trained his Tobiano mare over the past 6 weeks. When Roundup came in a few months, he'd show off the best cutting horse on the Circle P. Ty dropped to the ground and stretched his 6'4" rangy frame. A quick sweep took the high-crowned brown Stetson off his head so he could enjoy some of the breeze sneaking down from Baldy Butte. It wasn't that hot a day, but he tired out quicker these days, even if 57 wasn't that old. At least he told himself that was only half a lie. He unfastened his red bandana from around his neck and mopped the flood off his wrinkled, leathery forehead.
"You doing all right, Pa?"
"Not getting much sleep at night," he said. Ty declined to tell his oldest son any more. His darling wife, Beatrice, was working him the livelong night after he put in a hard day on the range. The Circle P wouldn't take care of itself, and neither would his wife's desire to have another baby. "Just one more," she said, "to keep her from feeling old." At 40, Beatrice wasn't old, not like he felt at this instant, but he hadn't been able to convince her of that. She wasn't one to give in easily, or ever give up. That was something he admired and loved in her. Usually. Ty worried that if his wife got her way, he wouldn't see the child grow up. He'd be almost 80 by the time the kid could vote. Working ranchers seldom made it that far, and the way he felt right now, Ty wasn't sure he'd make it to his next birthday. He'd wrenched his shoulder, just lassoing the steer all filled with bovine wanderlust. He watched his son ride away, guiding the wayward critter with assurance and considerable skill. He'd done well bringing up Matt and the rest of the Brannigan clan, even if they did give him headaches at times. Ty knew he was a lucky cayuse. He had a decent ranch, more than 1,000 head of cattle, and the best family any man could ever want. He was proud of each and every one of them. He caught up his horse's reins and walked to the top of a rise. The exercise got the kinks out of his legs, and even his throbbing shoulder felt a sight better. He looked out over his southern grays with some satisfaction. It was his. It was the Brannigan clan's. He jerked around as movement on the next ridge over caught his attention. Squinting, he pulled down his hat brim to shield his keen blue-green eyes. This temporary shade let him more closely see the silhouette of a rider. It wasn't unusual for men to pass through his land. Sometimes they stopped by the Circle P ranch house to pay their respects, and other times kept riding. He didn't much care, though Beatrice enjoyed fixing for a new face now and then. It broke up the daily routine and let her hear gossip from around the territory. Ty was less inclined to like the company. Men on the move were usually running from something, and going to any place that didn't know their faces. More than once, he had been like that. He'd left towns with no destination in mind, simply because the horizon promised new freedoms. The difference between his wanderlust then and most of the men riding Circle P land was that he'd never been escaping arrest. He shook his head. That footloose, easy philosophy had worn him down over a few years. By the time he'd put down stakes, he had become a deputy marshal, and then a full-fledged badge-toting lawman. For 10 years, he had gained the reputation of being a town tamer. Meeting and befriending some of the fastest hands in the West had been pleasant, for the most part. Meeting and gunning down the ones who thought they were the fastest and were intent on proving it eventually brought him to Warknife and Beatrice Salazar, the fiery, chili-peppered daughter of the town banker. The day he had asked Beatrice to be his wife and she had accepted was the day he turned in his badge. That was 21 years ago. He squinted a little harder and concentrated on the distant rider. Nostalgia was for old men. Ty Brannigan wasn't that old. Not yet, by damn. As he turned to mount, he stopped and took another harder look. Another rider. Both of them are looking out in yonder direction. He craned his neck around to figure what held those gents' attention. His eyes were not up to the task. The purple, hazy distance was only part of the problem, he realized. I need to remember those field glasses, he grumbled. Ty tried to see what they stared at so intently. He squinted hard, closed his eyes, and then popped open his eyelids. Then he saw it. You miserable animal, he muttered. He caught movement in the distant waist-high grass. It might have been the breeze, whistling down from higher altitudes, the wind that cooled him still. But he knew it wasn't. He'd been a rancher too long not to recognize the rhythm of a calf breaking off from the herd and hunting for trouble. Just like the steer, Matt returned to the herd far off in the other direction. A calf was heading out to explore when it ought to stay with the herd. Ty tugged on his horse's reins, swung into the saddle, and headed for the grassy bowl with the wayward calf plowing its way to danger. Halfway there, he looked back at the ridge. The two riders were nowhere to be seen. To vanish that quickly, all they had to do was ride a few yards down the far side of the upland. Astray was none of their business, especially if they only traveled through. He told himself that, but somehow it didn't set quite right, and he couldn't tell why. He reached the bottom of the marshy land and slogged along in the calf's wake. The grass was slowly returning upright to hide the path, but the calf was heading directly for an even lower section of land. Ty caught his breath when he saw how the ground beneath his horse's hooves changed with every step. The soggy earth was turning into real marsh. There had been heavy rains during the past week. If enough drained to the lowest part of the bowl, the mud might suck the calf in. He rode on another 50 yards before the piteous shrieks reached him. The sound made his horse jerk around uneasily. It was too close to the death cries of something in mighty big trouble. He reached for his rope, then cursed. Matt had it, and he hadn't asked for his son to either use his own lariat or hand over the one still dangling from his saddle. Ty urged his horse forward, but met with increasing reluctance. The mud sucked up past the fetlocks, making every step difficult and noisy. The horse was smart enough to know what danger it faced. Ty reluctantly admitted he wasn't as smart as his coyote done. Rather than get his horse bogged down, he drew rein and stood in the stirrups. He caught his breath. As he'd feared, the calf had blundered into a bog that slowly sucked it downward. It wasn't quicksand, not exactly, but the more the calf fought, the worse its predicament became. By the time it outright panicked, it would be a goner. Reaching it on foot was possible. He saw patches of drier land ahead. His horse wasn't going to make it that far, but he could on foot. From there, he had a chance to wrestle the calf out of its predicament. He kicked free and dropped into water over the tops of his boots. He gingerly stepped to the side and found firm ground. From here, he hopped from spot to spot, slipping and sliding along the way. His water-filled boots made it feel as if he had 100-pound weights on each foot. "I'm on my way. You stop fighting. Stop right now," his advice to the trapped bovine only caused it to thrash about more. The calf was already up to its belly in the sucking mud pit,
Ty paused a few yards away and considered what his chances were of rescuing the valuable hunk of beef on the hoof. It'd be another year or two before it was ready for market, but it'd fetch top dollar. To be this close to saving it and simply give up would rankle like a burr under his saddle for years. "Settle down now," he said, in as soothing a voice as he could muster. Ty wanted to shout, to rage at the dumb animal for not remaining with the herd in a perfectly fine pasture filled with succulent grass. Nothing he said would change the situation, only action. He judged how to approach the calf. It threw its head about and lowed in panic. Ty stepped to the edge of the dry patch closest to the calf. A quick step was all it took for him to realize his mistake. He sank up to his waist in the deep water. Sucking mud pulled at his boots. Ty frantically grabbed. His arms circled the animal's neck. This kept him from sinking more, but it also caused the calf to strain more to get away. He wasn't sinking any farther, but the calf was, and it began taking him down with it. Instinct caused Ty to swing around, shove out his hips, and arch his back. With his arms circling the calf's head, he twisted it around as if he was bulldogging it. Huge muddy bubbles rose from below. He had broken some of the suction drawing the calf under. Continuing to turn, he tried to throw the calf onto its side. That would give both of them a chance to kick free and find more solid ground. And it did. With a screech of triumph, the calf jerked free of Ty's grip and landed hard on its side on a dry section. It scrambled and kicked and fought and found its feet on compact soil. Without so much as a backward look at its rescuer, the calf raced off along a firm section, heading for the grass that had lured it into this trap. Ty let out a whoop of glee. He had saved the blundering animal. Then he realized there was another blundering animal caught in the mud. Him. He tried to float to get parallel with the hidden mire. The mud held him too firmly. Worse, he felt as if it was a huge animal, slowly swallowing him down its gullet. The pressure drawing him under was more powerful than anything he'd ever fought, and he was losing inch by inch. Ty jerked from side to side, but failed to break the suction that had pulled down the calf. As he splashed about, he looked up and saw salvation. "Hey, help!" his shout echoed through the shallow bowl. "Over here, I'm caught! Pull me out!" The two riders, likely the ones he had spotted on the ridge above, forked their horses and just stared. "I'm being drawn under! Get me out!" The riders never budged. Both men's faces were hidden in shadow, cast by the towering cottonwood next to them. "Throw me a rope! Help!" Ty held down panic as he realized neither man was moving to help. All either had to do was secure one end of a rope to the huge tree and cast a lasso out to him. He was close enough. If they did that, he'd be able to pull himself out. They didn't even have to exert themselves. The mud crept up to his thighs. The suction increased. The water sloshed up across his chest and threatened to gag him. Ty reached under the surface of the filthy water and found his stag-gripped Colt 44. He pulled it free of the water and shook out as much water as he could. Then he took aim. His first shot knocked splinters off the tree trunk to the right of one rider. The man flinched. The two of them exchanged heated words. Ty shouted for them to help. They turned back and stared at him. Neither moved a muscle to help. This time he didn't aim to get their attention. He aimed to take them out of the saddle. The hammer fell on a punk round. Water had ruined that cartridge. And the next, which made a dull pfft. The two men wheeled their horses around and trotted off as if they didn't have a care in the world. Tan and Brannigan watched until their backs vanished. Then he expended the last of his strength, trying to pull free. Water lapped around his mouth, his cheeks, up his nose. He sputtered out his final word. "Beatrice."
Chapter 2.
Heaven wasn't anything like Ty had ever imagined. It smelled bad, and was dark, and burned his eyes, and it stunk. Realizing that made him laugh. Heaven stunk to high heaven. As he laughed, he choked and spat out a mouth filled with slime. He fought and heard distant voices, not choirs of angels. A frightened voice, yet one speaking only to him.
"Come on, Pa, sit up. Open your eyes."
Hands shook him, hard. He felt muddy ooze run down his face and drip off his chin. He swiped at it. Somehow his hand still worked.
For some reason, he had always thought they wouldn't in heaven, but that was crazy. Everyone in heaven played a harp. He didn't like harp music, especially not for all eternity. The persistent voice returned, something rubbed against his face. He reached up and tried to push it away, but his hands failed. Irritation flared.
Pa, you're all right.
A cloth scrubbed his face and cleared his eyes. He blinked against the sunlight.
It's Wyoming, he said, the truth beginning to bring him around. He spat again and pushed his Stetson back on his head. Eyes took a few more seconds to focus. My boots are gone.
I've got them, Pa. They came off when I was pulling you out of the bog. I swear they had 100 pounds of mud in each of them.
He spat a final time and took the boots from his son. For a moment, Matthew was reluctant to give them to him, then relented.
I found your 6-shooter, too. You threw it out. Why'd you go and do a thing like that?
You didn't hear me firing it. Ty accepted his Colt and examined it. He had no recollection of heaving it away while he was caught in the mud. But when shooting the two who watched him sink failed, it must have been an instinctual reaction. They'd ridden off without so much as a fare-thee-well, leaving him to die. If he wasn't able to blow them out of the saddle, he'd try to brain them with his flying pistol.
I might have heard a shot, but sounds in this hollow are weird. The wind blows and it sounds like someone's moaning. The grass whips around and there are rocks with crevices that make it hard to hear anything. It's a good thing I did hear that calf.
It's back in the herd.
All safe and sound, Matt assured him. It came sauntering out all frisky and covered with mud. That's what got me to wondering where you'd gotten off to.
With an arm around his shoulders, his son helped him stand. Ty started to condemn the two riders, then held his tongue. Burdening his son with what had happened had consequences. Matt was sure to tell his ma about the rescue. Ty wanted to avoid having to explain to Beatrice how two owl hoots abandoned him the way they had. She got worked up enough. Once angry, his darling wife took a long time to cool off. After all he'd been through, all Ty wanted now was for some peace and quiet. As if that was even halfway possible with those two devils riding free on Circle P land. He looked at the mud-caked Colt 44. Peace and quiet would be good, so he had a chance to clean and oil his 6-shooter and reload with fresh ammo.
There's a stream not far from here with clear running water, Matt said. Ma's going to ask a lot of questions about how you got so filthy.
I need to clean up, for my own sake. The mud is drying out and it itches. Everywhere. He squirmed about. It took all his willpower not to scratch where it itched the most. Together, they walked out of the boggy area to the edge of the meadow where the Circle P cattle grazed contentedly. They neither knew nor cared that their owner had come within a hair of dying. Now all they noticed was the way he stunk from the filthy mud caking his clothing. Ty looked for the calf that had caused all the trouble. It blended in among dozens of other calves. The way he felt, if he had picked it out, there would have been one hell of a dinner of thick steaks for a week on the Brannigan dinner table.
I'll get those boots clean, Matt said. I think they'll be all right if I clean them, and you get them on while they're still soaked. You don't want them to dry unless your feet are in them. Otherwise, they'd shrink down to a size too dinky for even Caroline to wear, he said, meaning his younger sister.
The 12-year-old had small feet in a family where they were all above average height, with equally sized feet. The stream called to Ty. He stripped off his muddy clothing, leaving on only his balbriggans. He washed his shirt and suspenders the best he could. Wiping mud off his buckskin pants proved easier. The hide chased off dirt and seldom needed cleaning. A quick glance showed him where Matt sat cross-legged under a cottonwood tree, using handfuls of grass to wipe away the mud from his boots. When he got to town, he'd have the bootmaker give them a fresh cleaning with plenty of polish. Those were expensive boots and worth every cent he had paid. They'd lasted him 5 seasons already, and 2 of those years were blizzard winters. Properly cleaned and saddle-soaped, they'd be good enough long enough for him to be buried in. He intended that time to be a fair amount of time down the road. Ty splashed around in the water, then found a broad, slick rock and slowly slid along it until he floated face up with the current rushing past. He half-closed his eyes and relaxed. Mind drifting along with his body, he remembered the 2 riders who had left him to die. He opened his eyes and sat up with a start,
Two men stood on the bank, their horses' reins in hand. As the two had done before, they watched him in eerie silence. Ty's hand went for a six-gun. He splashed water rather than pulling the iron that remained on the stream bank.
"I declare, Cantor, we got ourselves. What do you call them sea critters that sun themselves on a rock?"
"Mermaids," the one called Kennard said. "I read myself a book once all about them, Ron." He grinned, showing two broken teeth and another that had been repaired with gold.
"Nah, that can't be. He ain't no mermaid. Are there mermen?"
"Don't see why not. Where'd all the little mer-babies come from if there wasn't?"
Kennard rested his hand on his holstered six-shooter. Ty stood slowly, even dripping wet and almost naked. He was an imposing figure. He towered above the two men on the stream bank. More than once, when he worked as a lawman, he had stared down at Drunk intent on shooting up a saloon. Once he had bluffed the Pecos River kid into backing down in spite of his six-shooter not being loaded, Town Tamer was a moniker he'd come by honestly. But now, he was in his underwear, and without a pistol, facing down the two men who'd almost certainly left him to die before.
"Have I seen you two before?"
Kennard glanced at his partner, who giggled like a little girl.
"He wants to know if our paths have crossed, Ron. What do you think? Have our paths crossed before this very instant? I ain't got a good recollection of that myself."
Ron moved to slip his iron from the hard leather holster tied down at his right hip.
"That's a distinct possibility, Connard,"
Ron moved as if dipped in molasses as he started to pull his gun. With the pistol only halfway out, he froze, for good reason. The heart-stopping sound of a Henry rifle cocking came from behind him.
"So you know him? You know Mr. Brannigan?"
Kennard looked over his shoulder, his and Matt's eyes locked, both peering down the long barrel of the Henry repeater. The only difference was that Ty's son was on the end, shooting the rifle. His finger curled around the trigger so tight that his knuckle turned white. The eye staring down the length of the rifle aligned the back notch and the bright front bead centered on Kennard's forehead.
"Take him out first, son," Ty said. "You'll have plenty of time to put another round in his partner."
His hands shaking. "Isn't it, Ron? Are those nerves you're showing?"
Ty knew how to put the fear into an opponent. "That makes you slower. I've seen it a dozen times."
"There's nothing wrong with my reflexes," Matthew said. "And I'm about the best shot within 100 miles.
"You want him to prove it, gentlemen?"
Ty saw both gunmen considering their next move. They decided right.
"We've watered our horses. Let's clear out," Kennard said. "There's no call putting up with unneighborly folks like these two."
"They're called Brannigan, ain't that right?"
Ron's hand shook even more. He judged distances and his chance of throwing down, spinning around and shooting Matt before the boy pulled back on the Henry's trigger.
"Enough, Ron."
This time Kennard's words carried an edge. He was smarter than his hot-headed partner, not that either of them showed a lick of sense confronting the man they had left to die, even if he was close and naked as a daybird. Ron grunted in response. They stepped up. Kennard mounted quickly. Ty was glad to see that his son remained alert the whole time. These sidewinders were dangerous. An instant's distraction would have set them off, hands flashing to their well-used smoke wagons. They trotted away, again not saying a word. Ty suspected they had ridden together so long that there wasn't much left for them to talk about, other than who to kill next.
"What was that all about?" Matthew asked. "They acted like they knew you and had it in for you."
"I don't know if I've ever seen them before," Ty said, hitting himself for the half-lie. If he had to positively identify, to swear in a Bible that this was the pair who had left him to die in the bog, he wouldn't be able to do it. But in his gut, he knew they were the ones.
"You've got a herd of cutthroats gunning for you after all the years you spent as a marshal," his son said. "Maybe they were hearkening back to those days when you tossed them in the pokey."
Ty shook all over like a dog, scattered bright water droplets everywhere, and stepped from the stream. The breeze had picked up, chilling him now. Goose flesh rippled along his arms and torso, but he wasn't sure it came from the wet and the wind. Men rode his range,
and he needed to protect his family from them. Watching his own back was part of that, from what Ron and Kennard had said.
"The herd's moving out of the pasture and heading south," Matt said. "You want to keep hunting for strays?"
He looked up at the sun, now sinking low in the afternoon sky.
"Head on back," Ty decided.
He dressed quickly. Strapping his six-shooter around his middle relieved some of the strain he felt. He might be getting up there in years, but his hand was still as sure as his aim, and his reflexes were the match of most of the new crop of gunmen. Men like Kennard and Ron were better served shooting him from ambush rather than facing him down. What worried him the most was that the kind of varmints they were saw nothing wrong with that, or leaving a man they didn't even know to get sucked to his death in a slough.
"Here, Pa," Matt held out the Henry.
"It was close at hand. I didn't hurt it none."
"Keep it safe for me. I'll stick it back into my saddle scabbard when I get home." "This is your pride and joy, Pa. Are you sure you trust me with it?"
"If you fire it, don't miss what you're aiming at," he said. He slapped Matt on the shoulder, sank to the ground, and pulled on his still damp boots. Ty looked up.
"You did a good job cleaning these. You've got a few good years left in them."
"A few years and a lot of miles," Ty agreed. "Get on home, and be careful what you tell your ma. I'll be along shortly."
"I should ride with you. You're going after them, aren't you?"
"Do as I tell you. Get on home." Ty waited for his son to step up and ride off. He waved Matt away when the boy looked back. Walking gingerly in the damp boots, Ty mounted and sat for a moment to get the feel of riding without his Henry repeater pressing into his knee. He drew his six gun and spun the cylinder. The time taken to dry it reassured him that it wouldn't fail him if he needed to get off a shot or two. While it needed oiling, that could wait. A final check of the cartridges bolstered his confidence in being able to handle any trouble he found, or trouble that found him. He trotted away from the stream, eyes fixed on the ground for the trail left by the two troublemakers. Near the water, hoofprints were obvious. As the pair climbed higher and crossed rocky patches, it took more skill to stay on their trail. A half hour later, Ty topped a rise where he could scan the countryside in three directions. A rocky spine blocked his view toward Baldy Butte. But the land all around was his. This was Circle P country, and the slowly moving, mooing brown and black masses scattered around were his. Ty took his time hunting for the two men. After 10 minutes of surveillance, he had to admit defeat. He looked toward Baldy Butte. Kennard and his pal must have made their way into the maze of rocks and canyons surrounding the butte. That proved to him that they weren't pilgrims just passing through. The land there was rugged, and the trails, as like as not, turned into box canyons. Wherever they rode, it wasn't away from the Powderhorn Ranch. While reading the future was always a fool's game, Ty felt he hadn't seen the last of the pair.
"Giddy up," Ty said, tapping his heels against the dun's flanks. "Time to go home."
Chapter 3
"Whoa, Bat! Don't rear up now! Down! Down!"
Gregory Brannigan tugged on the halter, but the colt refused to settle down. The 15-year-old moved in a circle like he'd seen his older brother do so many times. Keep the horse occupied and spinning. It was stronger than he was, so he needed to tire it out with constant pivots. He quickly found that what worked for Matthew wasn't working too well for him. If anything, the frisky colt became more rambunctious. Greg tugged on the headstall and lightly used a long, flexible switch against the horse's front shoulders to divert it. Nothing he did worked, not the way it did when he watched others do it. Matthew was expert at gentling wild horses. Greg wanted nothing more than to develop that skill, but he could only watch and try to learn that way. His brother never had time to show him, and his pa was always out riding picket, not that he blamed him. The herd had been restive these past few weeks, and nobody knew why. It was his pa's job, duty, to look after the cattle.
"Come on, don't do this to me," Greg called in frustration.
He snapped the slender switch against an exposed flank and got a reaction he hadn't expected. The colt came to a complete stop. Pulling on the halter the way he was caused the would-be trainer to fall to his knees. The colt laughed at him. Greg knew a horse laugh when he heard one, and he was on the receiving end of this one. A whinny replaced the echo in merriment, and then it reared, front hooves flashing out. Greg rolled over and under the bottom rail of the pole corral. The horse crashed down inches from him and then backed away. The whinny carried a sense of satisfaction at routing the foolish trainer. Furious, Greg climbed up to the top rail and threw his leg over. His timing was bad. The colt charged him like a bull, head down, as if it did butt him. It crashed into him and sent him flying. Worse, it knocked down the top rail. From where he landed, Greg watched in helpless horror as the colt took two steps back, then galloped forward. It cleared the lowered fence easily, hit the ground running, and was out of sight in seconds.
"No, you mangy cayuse! You miserable hunk of horseflesh! Come back here!"
He held back certain words he'd heard Matt utter on occasion, and his father once in a blue moon when things really went bad and they were out of earshot of his mother. He looked around to be sure no one had heard him. His two sisters, McKenna and Caroline, were nowhere to be seen, off doing chores. He saw his mother peering through the kitchen window. She had been preparing something special for their Sunday meal. Greg hoped it needed her constant attention so she wouldn't come out. She came out. He used his Stetson to brush away dust. Beatrice Brannigan marked straight for him. He had seen the look on her face too many times when he had done something wrong. About the worst was when he'd burned down the tool shed when he was 10 trying to roll and smoke a cigarette. The expression on his mouse face was almost that bad. It took all his gumption to stand his ground and not run and hide.
"What did you do? That colt cost your pa $100.
"It jumped the fence, Ma. I tried to stop it, but you were trying to break it and left the gate open," she said. "No, no, it jumped over the corral, see?"
He pointed. Anything that diverted his mother's wrath was helpful. She wasn't so easily decoyed away.
"Whatever happened, you let it get out of the corral. I should get a switch and give you a whipping for that."
"No."
Greg flushed with anger. His fists hung at his side, and he shook with rage.
"That's for babies, for little kids. You'd never say a thing like that to Matt."
"He's a man. You're still a boy," she snapped.
"I'm 15.
Greg puffed out his chest and tried to stand a little taller. Even at 15, he towered over his diminutive mother. He was 4 inches shorter than his pa and 2 shorter than Matt. But he looked down on Beatrice Brannigan. Somehow, the height advantage didn't give him the high ground in this argument. He might be bulky, maybe too clumsy and huge, but she was small and fiery.
"That's right, 15, she said. "You're a child yet. Look how you walk around. That's not the way a man walks."
Greg flushed even more. This time embarrassment caused his tongue to get tied up in knots. Both his pa and brother were tall and well-built and walked like cougars on the prowl. They were graceful, their step springy and quiet, like they were ready to pounce at any instant. When he walked around, it felt as if he were a bull in a china shop.
"I'm like a bear," he said,
more to himself than to his mother. They were graceful. He was powerful. He reared up just a bit more.
"Whatever you are, you let a valuable horse gallop out of the corral. You go fetch it back, right now, Gregory Brannigan, this very minute."
Her hot dark eyes bored into him. The set to her mouth and the frown wrinkling her forehead told him how mad she was.
"I was going to," he said lamely. "That old pony's not getting the better of me."
Beatrice Brannigan folded her arms across her chest and said nothing. That was worse than if she had raged and chewed him out, sometimes dipping into Spanish the way she did when she got really angry. Greg swallowed hard. The way she watched him was even worse than if he'd been told to go find a switch for a whipping. He tried not to storm off. Trying to march off like a man only caused his clumsiness to trip him up. He stumbled, righted himself, and blushed even more. His mother might have laughed at him. What she did was worse. She made a sound as if she was giving up entirely. It took him extra time to saddle up a bulky horse from the corral and ride out. The last thing he wanted was to hurry tightening the cinch on his horse and have the loose saddle spin around, dumping him to the ground. That had happened to him more than once. Usually able to laugh it off, now it would be like branding himself a failure. Worse, that was something a kid who didn't know what to do when a horse expanded its lungs and then relaxed after the cinch was tightened. Nobody took him seriously. Being treated like a child rankled with every petty chore he was assigned. Even at the dinner table, he was stuck down with his 12-year-old sister, and not at the other end of the table with the grown-ups. He wanted to get in on those conversations. They were important and had a lot to do with how the Circle P was run.
They knew enough to contribute, but they didn't listen. Even worse, they discounted anything he did get a chance to say, just as they did Caroline. She was a child. He was a man. "Prove it," he said, between clenched teeth. The colt was only one way to do it, but right now, finding the elusive animal and getting it back into the corral before either his pa or brother returned was all he thought about. The colt escaping hadn't been his fault. That rail falling down could have happened to anyone. Who knew the horse was such a good jumper when it hadn't been saddle-broke yet? He came to a road cutting through the Circle P property and looked both directions. The double-rutted road was perfect for a young horse to toss its head and then light out at a full gallop. But which way? Greg was good enough at tracking to find hoofprints in the soft dirt. But was this the colt or another horse? The road was here for a reason. Freight from Laramie came along this stretch on its way to Warknife. A rider alongside a freight wagon could have left those tracks. He dropped down and knelt. He measured the width of the hoofprint using his hand, then compared it with his own gelding's print. A smug, satisfied smile curled his lips. The horse making these tracks was smaller. It wasn't good enough to measure the stride, but the horse had been racing along. Greg swung back into the saddle and galloped after the colt. It was young and wouldn't be fully grown for months and months. It tired and slowed, letting him close the distance. He almost shouted when he saw the colt standing in the road ahead, tossing its head about and stamping with its front hooves. Rather than spook it again, he slowed his pace and approached at a slow walk. The colt spotted him and bolted, cutting away from the road and heading toward a stand of elm trees. He had ridden this part of the ranch more times than he could remember. The colt had sniffed out water and galloped for it. Following at a more sedate pace, he finally reached the spot where the colt bent low to drink. As he neared, it straightened and took a couple playful steps away from the water. Greg never hurried now. He reached down and unfastened his lariat. A loop played out and he held it by the Honda. "Go on, nibble at some of that fine grass. There's none finer in all of Wyoming," he said in a soothing voice. He still didn't swing the lariat around. The colt bounced around a little, then sampled the blue grama. Greg came closer. Closer, when the colt raised its head, finally realizing the predicament it was now in, it was too late. The lasso spun through the air and dropped neatly around a neck, straining to break free. Greg was good at roping calves. They were sneaky critters. The colt shared many of the darts and dodges, pulls and attempts to loosen the loop around his neck. Greg drew it into a manageable length, then let the horse cavort about all it wanted. "Gotcha," he said in satisfaction. It wasn't a hand who had ever worked on the Circle P who could have done this better. He took a couple turns around the saddle horn and turned back toward the road. It was time to go home and get the colt back into the corral, after he lifted the top rail back into place. He was pleased that the colt decided to trot alongside without making another break for freedom. When the horse suddenly stopped, it took Greg by surprise. "What got into you?" He started to jerk on the rope and get the horse moving again, when he saw the reason the colt had shied. Riding ahead, along the road, were three men, intent on getting somewhere fast. They cut diagonally across the road and headed for the high pasture where half the Circle P beeves grazed. They hadn't spotted him. While riders sometimes came this way, they seldom left the road to head into the Powderhorn's south meadows. Curious, Greg left the road and trailed the trio down a ravine and up a steep slope. He found the going harder with the colt. It was young and had finally run out of energy. The climb wore it out further. By the time they reached the top of the hill, the colt's flanks were lathered and it tried to break free again. "Settle down," he urged. He hunted for the riders, but had lost them. His heart jumped into his throat when he spotted three dark specks moving across the pasture toward the herd. The Circle P herd. Strangers had no business riding among cattle that didn't belong to them. Greg reached down and touched the shotgun in the saddle sheath. Then he straightened. All he had was his .410 shotgun. It was good for varmints. He'd killed more than one mountain rattler, too. But the varmints he watched intently now were pecking. A small-bore shotgun against the firepower those three carried meant only woe if he was stupid enough to challenge them.
He pressed his hand into his hip. He was old enough to carry a pistol like his pa and his brother. There'd be hell to pay if he had a Colt weighing him down, because he'd make those three fess up to whatever they were doing. "What are they doing?" he asked himself softly. He pulled down the rim of his Stetson to shield the setting sun and get a better look. As far as he could tell, they weren't cutting out any of the cattle. They rode through the herd, occasionally stopping and bending over as if they checked the brands. Greg had never seen any of the three before. The times his pa had taken him to the Wyoming Cattlemen's Association meetings, he had met some of the other ranchers and knew even more by sight. Nary one of the trio of riders belonged to the local cattle growers group, much less the bigger territorial association. Not that he knew, if only he'd had a chance to sit through an entire meeting instead of being hustled out to run errands for his ma. Matthew had stayed with their pa. Greg had asked what had been said, but his brother had gotten all high and mighty and only said grown-up business, and that he wouldn't understand. Greg understood all too well. He touched the slick spot on his right hip again. That was the place where a six-shooter should be secured. The three riders moved to the far side of the herd, spoke for several minutes, then galloped away in the direction of Baldy Butte. Greg longed to follow them, but the colt was turning feisty again, having rested up. "Come on," he told the horse. He tugged on the rope around its neck. "You're going back to the corral." Greg heaved a deep sigh. "After I repair it." He turned back downslope and returned to the road. The sun was setting fast, and he wanted to be home before dark. Like a good little boy, he should be home to wash up for dinner.
Chapter 4
"You're worried, Pa. I can tell. You haven't said a word since you got home."
Matthew Brannigan kept currying his horse, but his attention fixed on his father.
"It was them two strangers, wasn't it? Have you seen them before?"
"Where'd you put my rifle? I should keep it with my gear for when I need it. I don't want to ride out again and find it leaning against the barn wall." Tynan Brannigan had been lost in thought not only about how the two strangers, Ron and Kennard, had left him to die, but how they were willing to shoot him while he was taking a bath in the stream. They were low-down cutthroats, of that he was certain. He strained to remember if he had ever seen their ugly faces before. Not even a blurry wanted poster folded a half-dozen times came to mind. If he were a gambling man, he'd put down heavy odds they were strangers. So why did they have it in for him? If Matt hadn't rescued him both times, he would have been buzzard bait. That shocked him more than about anything else had in months and months. He wasn't ready to give up the ghost when the railroad deal was so close to coming true, and certainly not ever with most of his family left to raise. Caroline was only 12. It'd be another 6 years before she'd be grown up enough not to worry about her. Only he would. McKenna was 17, and he worried about her more than any of the rest. Mac had a way of finding trouble. He smiled grimly at that. She was a lot like him. They never looked for a predicament, but it found them as surely as if they were lodestones and trouble had a compass. But cashing in his chips now? Not for a while. Not for a long time, he vowed. "They're sniffing around the herd," Ty said. "I don't like that."
"The cattle have been kind of nervy of late," Matt said. "I've kept an eye peeled for a mountain lion or maybe wolves since the cattle began getting restive a week or two back. So far, I haven't spotted any predator's tracks."
"The snows were wet and heavy all winter long," Ty said. "That should give the little varmints, like rabbits and marmots, plenty to eat.
And with a lot of dinners hopping around, the coyotes and wolves don't have any call to come down and pester our cattle,"
Matt finished.
"There might be an old mountain lion not able to hunt as well anymore. Lose your teeth or strength enough to pounce, the calf starts to look like an easy meal."
"Or the cattle might be nervous because of two-legged wolves." Ty stopped currying his dun and stepped back. The vague uneasiness hardened into certainty. "Saddle up again. I've got a gut feeling that we might find what's upsetting our cattle if we get right on back out there."
"Can I take a Winchester, Pa?"
Matt looked at a rack nailed to the barn wall just inside the door. "Pick one and keep it for your own. You might be needing it sooner than you think."
"Today, having your Henry rifle in my hand sure felt good."
"You're man enough to know what it means to pull the trigger if you're aiming at someone." Ty saw the serious look on his son's face. He realized that
As settled as this part of Wyoming was now, that sudden death was always just around the corner. If you pointed a gun at a man, you had to be willing to kill. That was a powerful burden to carry, but he knew his son was up to it. "Thanks for trusting me, Pa." Matt made a careful selection, loaded the Winchester, and hefted it. "I've shot this one before. I like the way it feels." "It shoots down and to the left. The front sight is skewed," Ty said.
"Not any longer. I sighted it in last month while you were in town to visit Marshall Southern."
Matt pursed his lips, thought a moment, then asked,
"Are you going to let him know about those two?"
"Chris has plenty on his plate without me adding to it," Ty said. "They haven't done anything to get themselves arrested." He knew it'd be his word against theirs that they'd ridden off and left him to the mercy of the bog. Although he was for certain sure they had watched, knowing he would die if they did nothing, he couldn't swear on a Bible in court that they had seen him, or that they were the ones who'd turned and ridden away. And for all their talk, they hadn't done anything when they found him bathing.
"What do you think about me wearing a six-gun?"
The question came out of the clear blue. It took Ty a few seconds to sort through what he thought. "It's about time, but it's a tool. You know what your ma thinks of me wearing my six-shooter." He touched the .44 Colt and remembered it needed a more thorough cleaning and oiling. "I've got my eye on a Smith & Wesson at Logan's Gun and Ammunition Shop in town."
"We'll talk about it later. Let's ride and stay alert."
"But don't get jumpy," Matt finished, laughing. "I know, Pa, I know. I've heard you say it often enough."
Ty felt that his son did understand what he meant. Matt had done a powerful lot of growing up in the past year or two. If anything happened to him, he felt his son could keep the ranch running.
"As for I'm thinking thoughts I've no reason to think," he said.
Ty led his dun from the barn and stepped up.
"Let's go check the cows."
A reluctant twilight was surrendering to complete darkness. The moon wasn't going to come up for another hour or two, but the stars already shone brightly. The clouds that had drifted across the sky earlier in the day had all fled to wherever clouds hid. Because of that pristine sky, the stars gave light good enough for riding. Ty trotted out and headed for the south pastures. Matt rode beside him but wasn't inclined to idle talk. That suited Ty just fine. He turned over everything that had happened during the day and liked it less with every passing minute. His son had asked about reporting the two riders to Chris Southern. The Warknife Marshal was an old friend, but his wife Molly was feeling poorly. Ty wasn't inclined to dump his problems on Southern without more proof. Tending Molly ought to be his primary concern. When she got better, maybe then it'd be the right time to mention two varmints willing to let a man they didn't know die. Proof. Everything he had so far was his word against the two strangers.
"They weren't carrying bedrolls," Matt said suddenly. "Did they leave their gear in the camp? Where is that?"
Ty closed his eyes and tried to calm himself. He was mad now. Not at his son for pointing out the way the strangers rode around the Circle P, but at himself. He should have been more observant. "They come and go toward Baldy Butte," he said. "Maybe they've pitched camp there. That's rugged country, Pa. Not much water higher up in the hills unless you ride a ways. A man needs good reason to hide out and not camp along a stream." Questions to be answered. Ty told himself he had missed the details Matthew had spotted because of his ordeal in the bog. But being so tired was a bigger factor. He didn't snap back fully alert and questioning everything the way he used to. Letting things slide by was a good way to die. His pulse sped up and a thunder in his temples warned him not to get his dander up over this.
"Save it for when I need it," he grumbled.
"Save what, Pa?"
They brushed aside the question. "Do you hear that?" He cocked his head to the side and strained forward in the saddle.
"Something's causing the herd to move," Matt said. "Not wolves. This is unease, not panic. It's good that cattle have so few reactions."
"A stampede's no good under any circumstance," Ty said. Any given wild run meant several cattle died, either from being trampled by the bulk of the herd or by falling into arroyos.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.